We'll start. वागर्ताविव संप्रक्तौ वागर्त प्रतिपत्तये जगत पितरौ वंदे पार्वती परमेश्वरौ वसुदेव सुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं मूकं करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंघयते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वंदे परमानंदमाधवं दोर्भिर्युक्ता चतुर्भिर् स्फटिकमणिमयीं अक्षमालां दधाना हस्तेनेकेन पद्मं सितमपि च शुकं पुस्तकं चापरेण भासाकुन्देन्दुशङ्खस्फटिकमणिनिभा भासमाना समाना सा मे वाग्देवतेयं निवसतु वसने सुप्रता सप्रस सर्वदा सुप्रसन्ना सदा शिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तां वंदे गुरु परंपरां पार्थाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथिता पुराण मुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीमष्टादशाध्यायिनीं अम्बत्वाम् अनुसन्धदामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणीं ॐ ओके So there are a few questions, so we'll quickly, these questions are also very interesting. I think it gives us an opportunity to a little bit think beyond what we are discussing. The first question says, in Gita, my mother said, it is mentioned about Sattvic Dana. She wanted to know about which Dana is considered of higher order or priority. Dana to poor, Dana to girl child, or the Kutumba, distant relative included, or Dana to temple, or Dana to Brahmin. Thank you. So this is a question. See, in chapter 17, yes. Shraddha Traya Vibhaga Yoga, there are three types of Dana. Sattvika Dana, Rajasa Dana and Tamasika Dana. See, the charm of ancient Indian literature is it will provide only broad, you know, principles. It will not say don't give to this, don't give to X, don't give to Y. It will never say. So therefore the Sattvika Dana is not determined whether you gave it to a girl child or a poor person or a Kutumba or but Sattvika Dana is determined by only one criterion. Dātavyam yeti yad diyate tad dānam sattvikam smritam. This situation requires that he must be helped, she must be helped. No, what is in it for me? Nanke enu prayojana? Adilla. In this situation, we have to give. That is the best thing that can happen. Such a dana is called sattvika dana. Pratyupakara, pratyupakara, pratipala yen ide. Nothing. They are not. In fact, to expect that because I gave somebody some dana, that person must be grateful to me is Rajasik dana. That is not Sattvik dana, that is Rajasa. Pratyupakara, now when we look for Pratyupakara, that is called Rajasik. So therefore, all of them may be qualified. Dana, about dana, Bhagavad Gita does not say, in Dharma Shastra it is available. Who should be given? Bhagavad Gita is not Dharma Shastra. Bhagavad Gita draws from that and puts governing principles. So Sattvika Dana is Dana which is given without any expectation whatsoever. This situation demands that person must be helped. That is called Sattvika Dana. In Dharma Shastra they are available. Patra There are six principles. Who should be given, how should be given, how much should be given, what frame of mind you should give, all those are there. That is the process of giving. Sattvika Dana talks about the attitude of giving. So that is the answer to that. So the priority is established in Dharma Shastra, which we can understand. There is another question, sir. Can you please explain Shloka 7 again? What do you mean by Atman? Please explain with an example once more. So I'll quickly do that, because since the question has come, I should not skip it. Let me go to. So in the 17th sloka, yaha tu atmaratihi eva syat atma triptascha manavaha atman eva saha santushtaha tasya karyam na vidyate. There are three times atma is used. See, rati, ramyate iti rati, that which is interesting is called rati. So atmarati, which means I revel only in my own reference frame. My happiness, my joy is not contingent on what is happening outside. Moment you try to link your joy or your happiness to anything outside your control, then you have lost control, because that person can put so much of grief in you. So the Atmarati, Atma Tripti, Atmani Eva Santushtaka means, what it means is the reference frame for us to take any decision is world inside, not world outside. World inside means my sakshi. What is my sakshi saying? What is my conscience saying? What is my vyaktitva? Is my vyaktitva blossoming, flowering when I do something? If there is a person who requires a help, you try to help, at that time you will find Atma Rati. You will find Atma Tripti. You will Atmanyeva Santushtaka. There is a feeling of, I have helped somebody. I am happy, I have done something. That is why anything which touches your heart is more stronger than anything which touches your brain. Brain is all ahankara related. Heart is related to Atma. Anything which is touched your heart is very powerful. Anything which touched your brain is ahankara. It only bloats your ego. So that is the meaning of the word Atma here, which is what I think this question was all about. There is another question which came just before. It says, what is Japa Yajna? What is Yajna Bhavana? What is Upamsu Japa? What is Vachaka Tapas? What is Manasika Tapas? In chapter 17 of Bhagavad Gita, there is something called Kayaka Tapas, Manasiya Tapas, Vachika Tapas. See, there are only three ways we can communicate. There are only three ways we can conduct ourselves in the world. One is Manas. Because Manas has to decide what to do. I have to hate him, I have to like him, I have to give him a slap, I have to, you know, talk ill of him, all that, or I have to think good of him, I have to be grateful to him, I have to count my blessings, all those happens in Manas. And that is executed by the body language. In English they say body language. Sometimes the way you operate is more evident as a body level, and you know in Chandogya Upanishad it says, tongue, speech is the fire. In Chandogya Upanishad it says, speech is the fire, because some people can speak and you will burn of rage. Speech has that power. So Vachika Tapas is Anudvekakaram Vakyam. In chapter 17 of Bhagavad Gita it says, Anudvekakaram, Udvekakaram. Some people say one sentence, your BP will go up. Udvekam. Anudvekam means, people talk, nothing happens to you. You are cool. So that is called Vachika Tapas. So Vachika Tapas is using this faculty called speech and controlling it and doing it in such a way that it doesn't spill anything outside. That is Vachika Tapas. And so the Manasa Tapas, all these are important. Upamsu. Upamsu means, tapas which is done, Vachika and Upamsu is used in another thing. A mantra when you say. See, tapas, japa is mantra. See, Rama Japa means Rama, 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 we say. There are three ways we can say. One is you can Rama, 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 you know, outward. That's called Vachika. Okay? Upamsu means the sound is not there. There is no sound coming. In silence you say. That is Upamsu. Manasika Tapas means Rama is in my mind. I close my eyes and I see the picture of Rama in front of me. I can do tapas like that. So that is a manasa tapas, upamsa and vachika. In that, so whether you contemplate on it, you silently tell or you tell loudly. So that is where those three words are coming. So that's a question. All these obviously will lead to dhyana, because any effort for tapas and upasana is only condensing your thoughts. Otherwise the mind has a tendency to go all over the place. So this is a sort of a way by which you can converge. Then there are other questions, which I probably will take. The other questions tomorrow I will take, because they require.
In that class one, what about manasik and vachik and which has the greatest effect out of this?
So what it says is, the rule is that upamsu is far superior to vachika. Upamsu is far superior to vachika. Manasika tapas is even better. When you exercise higher control only, you can do it. At the moment you close your mind, think of Rama, exactly 1.5 seconds you go to, you know, something else. Then you have to bring the mind back. So those kind of things happen. Okay. So we will continue. 19 shlokas we saw. More or less 20 shlokas. 20 is sort of... So in the first 19 shlokas, Sri Krishna firmly established the basis and the notion of a few things. What are those? What is work? Why is it inevitable? He said in chapter Sloka 4 or 5, there is nothing like not doing work. Work is inevitable. Nobody can escape from work. Then he said, where can it lead it to an individual? Na karma namana arambat, naish karma purushaha ashnate. You can evolve as an individual. How to do work? He says, tadartam karma kaundeya mukta sangha samachara, yajnatat loko anyatra karma bandhanaha, all those. And the concept of yajna, all these we have done. All these are the building blocks and the core building blocks of karma yoga. If we are able to practice all that, we will be more or less close to being a karma yogi. Now we will see, from now on, in the next 6-7 shlokas, what will happen when a person has mastered the art of practicing the karma yoga. Because he has understood the value of yajna, he has understood how to do work. If we are able to practice a little bit of that, so the next important message that we will see, the quality of leadership will go up. A karma yogi, nobody can match a karma yogi when it comes to leadership. In the world of vyavahara, we have to have a leadership also. We have to lead. Sometimes we have to take the lead. Now, a person without no karma yoga will be a bad leader. And a person who has understood karma yoga will radiate with a very different style of leadership. So Sri Krishna gives us nice management lessons on leadership on these, because a karma yogi has a different lens with which he sees this whole idea of leadership. Today we have between 2 o'clock to 5:30, I discuss this chapter in a regular class in IIM Bangalore. In great length I talked about leadership. Then at 5:20 I closed it. I said, I have to go. It so happens I am going to talk the same thing in a shorter version here. I had a group of 40 working students, senior students, for whom I discussed this idea of leadership. So let us see the shlokas. Karma karma naiva hi hitam siddhim astita janakadayah loka sangrahamevapi sampashyan kartum arhasi. Karmane eva, karmana eva, I am sorry, A plus E only I will become. Karmana eva hi samsiddhim astita janaka deha. Janaka was one of the greatest kings known to this country. Not because he is, Sita's father, not because of that. If anybody has seriously read ancient Indian wisdom, what you will find is, Janaka was a very, very important person in the Vedic lore. In Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, Yajnavalkya, the great Rishi, Yajnavalkya, Janaka was one person who may be a Kshatriya, because he is a king, but his reach of knowledge belittled was all great learned Brahmins were paling in comparison. There was another king called Ajatashatru. Ajatashatru was the king of Kashi, and Brahmins went and learned from them because they were nowhere near the Kshatriya. So there everything was such an open society. While occupational hazards are called Kshatriya, Brahmana, Shudra and all these are occupational hazards. In your self-growth, nobody is sort of stopped. They had many examples like this. So Janaka, in his court, from time to time, he will invite, it's like conference, Vedic conference will happen only in Janaka's court. So once he called all the greatest, Vedanta scholars, these great Brahmins and so on, and said, I have a question. Anybody who wins me in the argument will have 1,000 cows and in the horns you have gold tied. So all these learned rishis are all come, Yajnavalkya comes in. Yajnavalkya is a great rishi. Yajnavalkya comes in and tells his sishya, take all these 1,000 cows and go. So all the other Brahmins are all very upset. We are all waiting to try to answer a question. You walk in and then you take it away and go. You have not even answered. What is going on here? So for which Yajnavalkya said, I need all these 1,000 cows for me. Question, answer and all I will see. In his own wit he said, he knows everything. He said, I need these 1,000 cows. That is why I asked my Sishya to take it and go. So I need anyway. So that is what he said. And then there was a great conversation. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, best part of Brihadaranyaka Upanishad is this conversation. That kind of reference is here. Don't think Janaka is an ordinary reference. So what is Krishna saying here? Janaka Adaya, Adi, say Adayaha. It ends with Adayaha. See, in Sanskrit, Adi. Adi means in English we say et al. If you want to say A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, you don't say everything. You say A, B, C, et al. Dot, 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 dot. So in plural, Janaka Deha, Janaka like people, hundreds of them, hundreds, thousands of them, I do not know. Janaka Deha, Samsiddhi Mastitaha, they reach the ultimate Siddhi. How? Karmana Eva, through work, not hiding behind somewhere in the forest, nothing of that kind. You need a natural progression to become a sannyasi. We talked about it in the 2 days before. Becoming a sannyasi, renouncing the world cannot be done. It should happen as a very natural process. Otherwise, bulk of the world is vyavahara in which we can evolve and reach videha mukti. There was a great Nisargadatta Maharaj in Bombay. He was in the slum. Great Siddhi. He was a great rishi. Passed away in 1983. In 1880 something he was born somewhere in Maharashtra. He was selling BD, ED and all that. But then he is such a great personality. So, we don't have to necessarily, that's what he is saying, through karma you can reach the highest level of realization. So, karmana eva hi samsiddhim astitaha janakadayah, and having reached the highest level of evolution, what did they do? Loka sangraham eva api sampashyan. How did they perform work? The biggest difference between a karma bogi or a karma rogi and a karma yogi is a karma bogi will do work only with what is in it for me. What will I get out of it? How can I benefit? That is called karma rogi. Whereas a karma yogi will do loka sangraham eva api sampashyan. His only thing is loka kalyan. This society, that is a sustainability argument. That is called sustainability. Everything, Vasudeva Kutumbakam. Let everybody flourish. I also want to flourish, but everybody must flourish. That is called Lokasangraha. So his perspective changes. So that will bring a very different handle to leadership. So now let us see what kind of leadership Krishna is bringing out of a person of, of this great character like Janaka and so many great people. He says, let me now tell you how will in the world of Vyavahara you will completely change. Your handle on leadership will completely change. There are some 6 beautiful slokas which we will see. Yadyad acharati sreshtaha tadad eva tarojanaha sayat pramanam kurute lokastadanuvartate. All that in the last 10 years, 15 years in management, walking the talk, leading by example, these kind of words are all being used in some management places, big executive seminar. They are all here. They are all here. What is he saying? Yat acharati. Kaha acharati? Sreshtaha. People who are looked upon are leaders. Whatever they do, yat acharati sreshtaha. All these people, whatever they do, tat eva. Eva means indeed, that alone, nothing else. Tat eva. Itaro janaha. So all other people will only do what the leader does. This is called leading by example. This is what in common management they say, leading by example. Yadyad acharati sreshtaha, tatyad eva itara janaha. All the other itara janaha, all others will do only that. Saha kaha sreshtaha. That leader, saha yat pramanam kurute, he says this is the way to do. Not by talk, by deeds. Talk and all, everybody can talk. It is not about talking, it is about not preaching, it is practicing. So, saha yat pramanam kurute. How do you do pramana? By responding to a situation in a particular way, you establish a pramana. This is the way to do, not by talking. Because I have seen in companies, cost cutting, they say, and the CEO flies in business class. You cannot do cost cutting like that. If you have to do cost cutting, you have to first cut. Then people will follow. You have to cut first. Then only people will do. Otherwise, everybody knows what to do. We know enough of all this. I don't want to talk about all that now. But that is what it is. It says, saha yat pramanam kurute, lokaha means the world around him, people who are all looking at him, lokaha tat anuvartate, anu means follows, the upasarga anu, that's why anuja is a younger brother, one who is followed in birth, anu janmam praptaha anujaha, so anuja, agraja is front, anuja is younger, no, the anu is the upasarga in Sanskrit, means follows. So anuvartate. So whatever he does, he will actually follow. That's what he says. Now the most shining example, I am telling you, every one of us are leaders. Don't even think, nah, I am not a leader. You don't have to have a CEO card to become a leader. You don't need to be very high in your hierarchy to be. Every one of us is a leader. Do you know where? The first place where we become a leader is as father and mother. The child looks at us very, very intensely. How did we know? I used to, you know, keep telling Sujata sometimes that we used to exchange notes. Now what happens? We have seen in some of the family circles. This child is 3 years old, bubbling with vocabulary, talking, right? The child uses exactly the same bad words either the father uses or the mother uses. You know why? You know, modern psychology, I don't know what it is saying. The child learns everything between the age of 1 and 3, period. If between the age of 1 and, let's say, if not 3, take 4. Want to add one more year, 5. 1 and 5. Between 1 and 5, if the young parents don't behave like perfect human beings, they have lost one generation. You cannot reclaim that. Don't think I am scaring. This is a reality. When you bring up child, the child will very intensely look at, what is father doing? What is the mother doing? That only it will follow. That's what Krishna is saying. Yadyad acharati sreshtaha, tadyad eva itara janaha. Tayat pramanam kurute, lokas tadanu vartate. See, I was doing something 10 years back. See, even in Brahmin community, in fact, all the three varnas are supposed to do sandhyavandana, all those are gone. Brahmins have also lost now. This biggest foolish ritual is called Upanayana. It has become, they have reception, they spend a lot of money on everything other than why an Upanayana is required. So I was a little worried, I was a little bothered. So in my small Swadhyaya, I offered people, I will teach for your child, if you want to learn Sandhyavandana, I will teach, no problem. So I used to ask them, I even went to one of my relatives' house and then I taught 15 days, I took pains to adjust my schedule, because I know the young kids will pick up fast. I stopped it after 2 years. You know why? The father is not doing anything. Why will the son do? So I have actually stopped attending Upanayanams. I am very selective in attending Upanayanams. Only in those places where I know they mean business, I go to Upanayanam. I don't go. Yadyad acharati sreshtaha tadyad eva itara janaha. If parents don't behave, you can tell tall moral stories. There are time pass for the kid. Kid knows. The child knows what to pick from the boy and the girl knows what to pick from the parents. Parents, other elders. So this is not an ordinary shloka. This is the crux of building society, both in a professional life and in personal life. That's what Krishna is saying here. Look at the next shloka. It is even interesting. Name parthasti kartavyam trishu lokeshu kinchana nanavaptam avaptavyam vartayeva cha karmani. So, he says, hey Partha, na me asti. In me there is not there. What is not there? Kartavyam. Work to be done. Name parthasi kartavyam trishu lokeshu kinchana. In the three worlds, I have no work to do. Honestly speaking, that is the situation. Krishna is saying, in the three worlds, I have no work to accomplish at all. Okay? That is the first line. Name partha asti trishulekeshu kartavyam kinchana. There is nothing that I have to do in the three worlds. That is the first line. And why he has nothing else to do, nothing to do in the three worlds, that he is explaining by the next half sentence in the second line. He says, na anavaptam avaptavyam. Both are put together. See, avaptam means obtained. Anavaptam means not obtained. Okay? Then there is another negative behind, before that. Na anavaptam. See, anavaptam itself is not obtained. So he says, the list of not obtained is not there. There are two nots there. Not obtained. In other words, if you ask me, please show me the list of things that you have not obtained. He says, no, I have no such list. It is empty. I have obtained everything. That is a two negative make a positive. So finally, what he is saying, I have obtained everything. Then avaptavyam. Avaptavyam is things which I have to obtain in the future. It is called wish list. See, nowadays they use the word wish list. So he says, if you ask me, is there anything that you have not achieved in your life? No, sir, that is empty. That's all right. Do you have any wish list for the future? That is also empty. So he has there. I have nothing to gain. The situation today in the world is, if we have nothing to gain, we'll switch off everything and sit at home and enjoy. Because we are all working for what is in it for me. Honestly, in some ways. Something we are looking for. So he says, name parthasti kartavyam trishu lokeshu kinchana. Why? Because nanavaptam avaptavyam varta. So, you know, it is not there. There is nothing that my list is empty in terms of unachieved. My list is empty in terms of what is to be achieved in the future. That is why I don't have to do anything. However, finally what is he saying? Varta eva cha karmani. Even when the situation is like that, I will ceaselessly work. How much of work he did in the name of Bhagavad Gita, he gained nothing out of it. He only got some brickbats. The whole Mahabharata, he got only brickbats. He gained nothing. He said, I have nothing to gain. I have nothing to achieve. That doesn't mean I will close the shop and then I go. Because today we call it as retirement. We say, enjoy Madi, we will go post-retirement enjoyment. That also is possible. He says, no, I will work. That is what a Karma Yogi says. I will ceaselessly work. Greatest Karma Yogi I saw in my life is a great doctor by name Dr. Venkatasamy. He built a world-class hospital called Arvind Eye Hospital. There is 300 Telugu families which have settled 60 kilometers from Madurai, south, very close to my native place. Oh, 300 families. None of them educated. Slowly people were getting educated. The V. Gopal Swami, a Tamil Nadu politician, he is also from there. All of them have an ending of Sami. This doctor is called Venkatasamy. They are all Telugu establishment there. This man was the first person to educate as a doctor. He goes and joins the army. At the age of 25, he was discharged. He was good for nothing. Severe attack of arthritis. He cannot stand. His hand was like this. How can he do eye surgery with a finger is not together like this. Finger is like this. Because of severe attack of arthritis. He was discharged. at the age of 26 from the army. He is a man with character. Otherwise, people would have easy thing to commit suicide. You don't have to come back home. You can take some medicine and then that's end of it. They are all weak-hearted people. They have not understood that I have taken a janma for a purpose. He didn't do any of those. He came back all the way. People thought he may be a defeated soldier. He was not a defeated soldier. His fire in the belly never quenched. You know what happened? He went and joined the government Rajaji Hospital in Madurai. Worked there at the age of 58. At the age of 58, he retires from Madurai Rajaji Hospital and starts a world-class hospital called Arvind Eye Hospital. At the age of 58, when people are retiring, he started a world-class hospital. Why am I calling it as world-class hospital? There are two best hospitals in the world. Harvard Institute of Medical Sciences, Johns Hopkins. These are the best hospitals in the world. Doctors from those two best hospitals, there is a one-year waiting list to intern in Arvind Eye Hospital, Madurai. That is a legacy he created after the age of 58. And then what happened? 2005, he passed away at the age of 87. I had the great fortune. God has been kind to me. I have seen leaders like that in my life. Worked a little bit with them, meaning interact with them and so on. In 2005, he, at the age of 88, in the month of July, he slipped into coma. He might have done 500,000 surgery with the hand, like the way he holds his forceps here and then does the surgery, is an art. At the age of 87, in July 2005, he slipped into coma and they thought end of Dr. Venkatasamy has come. 3 weeks later, he recovered. He was in the wheelchair, back into the hospital. He back into the hospital, November he died. I was the editor of my journal. I said, this is the greatest thing I have seen in my life. I said, he is the greatest social entrepreneur I have seen. You know what is the model of his eye care? He said, I will restore the precious gift of sight back to people. This is his vision. One-third pay, two-third free. Two-third free. One-third pay. Narayan Hridayalaya, Devi Shetty are inspired by Dr. Venkatasamy. He is like this. He has nothing to achieve. He has achieved everything. Yet he worked till his last breath. Vartha eva cha karmani. This is the hallmark of a karma yogi. We need karma yogis in this country. We don't want multinational executives who are productive. Production and all will come automatically. We need karma yoga. We need karma yogis who have spirit with which they lead the country, with which they lead organization, lead families, lead societies, lead social clubs. Everywhere we need karma yogis. See what else he is saying. Because he says, with this frame of mind, if you don't get into, you will get into holy laziness. This is all holy laziness. And I have achieved everything, so I will just keep it. My wants and needs are not that, therefore let me not work. That is called holy laziness. Swami Ranganathanda used that word. I picked it from his book actually. So the only powerful antidote for holy laziness is Yajna Bhava. This world is a grand Yajna of divinity. Please pour your ghee and go. Pour your ghee means Shamadana. Till you breathe last, do it. That is called Yajna Bhava. And Krishna argues, why is he doing it? Why is he doing when he has not to do anything? Yadi hyaham na varteyam jato karmanya tandritaha mama vartmanu vartante manushya partha sarvashaha. This is the real lesson of leadership. He says, you know what is leadership? Leadership, you have lost your degrees of freedom. Moment you become a leader, the whole world will look. It's like as though you are sitting in a glass cabin with a 360 degree view. You may think you are sitting in a concrete room with nice 2-3 doors. That is not truth. People don't have to walk into your office. They know what you are. That is the job of the subordinates. So he says, you know why I am doing? Yadi is if. He indeed, aham, he plus aham becomes hyaham in sandhi. Yadi hi aham na varteyam jatu karman atandritaha. I don't use my indriyas, I jolly well sit doing no work because I don't have to work. Because I have nothing to achieve. So I will not disturb anybody, I will just keep quiet. If I am like that, he says, mama vartmanu vartante, everybody will do the same thing. This is the bane of leadership. Leadership is not a very enjoyable thing. Leadership is a burden. Krishna says leadership is a burden. If you are a leader, better behave. Everybody is going to look at you very carefully. The moment you stop, they will stop. See, 20 years back, there was a movie. Kamalasan acted this movie called Nayakan. When I read these shlokas, I am reminded of that movie. See, this story has two parts. I am seeing Bhagavad Gita principle also there. My students tell me, sir, when you go to a restaurant, you become an operations manager. Because I am a professor of operations management. So when I go to a restaurant, I look at capacity, you know, lead time, how fast does it happen. So like that, wherever I go, I see only Bhagavad Gita now. For me, it's only Bhagavad Gita. So in this movie, there are two parts. These three shlokas are actually being demonstrated so well in the movie. In the first half, this fellow becomes a big dadagiri. Dharavi slum and violence, ailments, all that. You remember that is what the story is. Look at the second half of the story. In the second half of the story, Varadaraja Mudaliyar or whatever, that Nayakan, the hero, the daughter is reforming the hero. The daughter is telling, don't do violence. Why are you doing violence? It is not good. The movie will go like, you have to look at it from that lens. So what happens, the powerful story in the second part of the movie is the leader does not want violence, but his followers are not ready to listen. They are unleashing violence. That is what Krishna is saying. Being a leader is not easy. Whatever you do, people will look around you very, very intensely. So finally he found his end also. The same police constable's son killed him. That's the story. But this is the message I see here. When you are a leader, behave. Because once you become a leader, you have lost control. People will do, thinking this is what you want. You have no control on your followers. So you have to behave very, very carefully. So leadership is a great burden. As a parent, leadership is a great burden. Because our children will look at us very intensely. We don't even know they are looking at us. So don't think that you have closed the door and everything is alright. No. They will know how to understand what you are doing. Because yad yad pramanam kurte tatte anuvartate. Say saha yad pramanam kurte lokaha tat anuvartate. That is the reality of life. So it's very important for us to know that leadership can be a very different thing if you are actually a karma yogi. So that is what Krishna is saying in these three shlokas. So he is giving a very, very important dimension to leadership. First of all, what is he saying? Don't work with the principle of what is in it for me, which is coming from the Yajnabhava. Saying you do because it has to be kartavyam iti karyam karotu. Do work because that situation demands that. A leader should also be like that. A leader must be able to say, I will keep what is in it for me away. See, this is something which we have to practice in life. What is in it for me, keeping away, we have to do small little experiments. That experiments will teach us, not the Bhagavad Gita teaching. That small little experiments will actually teach us. If we can keep what is in it away for me and then try it, it will give a huge difference. I teach an elective course on Bhagavad Gita. Now, I am in Bangalore for the last 3 years. So what started with 30 people has now grown to 130, 140 of my students take it. So the way I teach this course, in this course, I show 20 videos. Every day there will be a video. Video are all from... I have really found that this YouTube is the greatest boon I have got, because you can teach anything with YouTube. Good things are available. You have to see. What you see, you will get. Wonderful videos I have located. So every day I show a video and I tell my students, tell me what is happening here. I will tell you one such example. There's a book. If you can buy that book and read, it's only about 300, 400 rupees. The book is titled Unsung. UNSUNG. Unsung heroes actually. Unsung. There are 11 beautiful stories. 11 beautiful stories in this book, small book. The book is not at all difficult to read because it is written by two photographers. So a story is only 10 pages. Out of 10 pages, 7, 8, about 4, 5 pages is only photos. I am amazed by their ability to write very little and create a huge impact on you. There are 10 beautiful stories I have seen. I will tell one story. India is full of such people, I am telling you. We have to see. Our Sanatana Dharma has not even an iota, it has not come down. Don't go by the TV, don't go by what you see in the TV and all that. They are not the reality. I'll tell you one story. Subhashini Mistri. This lady lived, I'll take the story in a present tense. This lady lives in a place 60 kilometers away, 24 Barkana's district, I think, 50-60 kilometers away from Kolkata. Very poor lady, domestic help, get some, a few rupees. Husband is there, I think three children, two boys and a girl or something like that. The husband is severely ill. I don't know, because of some drinking practices, that story I do not know. But anyway, the fact is, the husband is ill, she could not get a medical help. Husband has died. Avaru setu idare, enu madakke agilla. She didn't get the medical help. Now look at this lady, she is not educated. The fire in her belly, instead of quenching, grew into great flames. You know what she did? The first thing she said, that I will stop doing the domestic work because it does not leave any money for me. I have three children to be educated. With this domestic help I cannot do. Also I will not be in 24 Barkanas because it is far away. She comes close to Kolkata and then starts selling tarkarigalu, vegetable. She becomes a vegetable seller because she gets apparently a little more money. You laugh at this idea. And why she wants money? She wants to build a hospital. She wants to build a hospital and a worker like this, domestic servant, a widow, three children to be. But God is great. You know what God will do? When people have Yajna Bhava, God will pour fortune into those people. You know what happened? Slowly, 100 rupees, 100 rupees, 50 rupees, 30 rupees, whatever she saved, she bought one small land. It's a useless land, a small rain also, this much water. That's why it was cheap. She bought the land. These kids were all studying slowly, she put them. God's grace, those kids were brilliant. They were studying. The eldest son became a doctor. That was a long story. We can imagine the struggle she would have gone through. The eldest son became a doctor. In the meanwhile, in that small land, she was begging the doctors, can you not come for 1 hour a day? Now somebody come and ask you, sir, we are all so underprivileged. Can you spend half an hour Shramadana? Nobody in this room will say no. You will not say no, first of all. And most of us will go also. If not 1 hour, we will at least go half an hour. So doctors were coming. Thatch shed, tin haki, open yard. It was going on like that. Finally the story ends. I don't want to tell the full story. You can see, Google for Subhashini Mistri. You can Google for humanitarian hospital. You will find some interesting stories. Finally, this 10-page story ends by saying, the governor of West Bengal, Gopalakrishna Gandhi, comes and inaugurates the hospital, which was built by this lady and the son, who has now become a doctor. And the best part is, after that, this lady says, my world belongs to the pavement. I will continue to sell vegetables. I will offer pranams to her. She is a very evolved karma yogi. She never usurped power and said, this is my hospital, I will now start bossing over. No. She said, my world belongs to it. My God has shown hand to my son will do. It's okay. That is, single-pointed focus for Loka Sangraha. His husband is dead, he should have gone. The world is bad, all people are bad here, nothing happened, she can become a criminal also. That shows the strength of character we have inside. She worked against odds. I couldn't believe that a domestic help can get the governor of West Bengal to inaugurate. It was stunning. When I heard it, I bought the book. There are 10 such stories. I told one story. There are 10 such stories you must read. We can get inspired. There are any number of people like that in this country. Any number. I show 20 such videos to my students. I tell them, please, God has been kind to you. Please come and do something about it. In IIM Bangalore, when students come in, 450 students come. We do an orientation program. 1 week orientation program. Last session they give it to me. Then regular classes start. For the last 4 years I have been doing. They say, Professor Mahadevan, can you? As soon as I go there, 450 students tell sit there. I tell them, I want to tell you the story of Prahlada. This all the, you know, eyes start shrinking. You know, what is this pravachan going on here? I tell them, I want to tell you the story of Prahlada. You know, when Hiranyakashipu was torn to pieces, nobody could go near Narasimha. This boy went. This Prahlada went. And there is a beautiful, you know, Bhagavatam, there is a beautiful stotra which Prahlada does to Narasimha. At that time, this small boy asks, first thing he asks, so all the rage and anger of Narasimha comes down. So Narasimha asks, what do you want? So this boy says, first of all, I want my father to be redeemed. He has done all mischief. He should be redeemed. You know what was the reply? Narasimha. Swami says, Narasimha Avatara says, the day you are born, 21 generations are redeemed. 14 generations this side, 7 generations that side, 21 generations are redeemed. I tell this story to my students. Until then they are not interested. Because they don't know why I am telling this story. Then I tell them. Do you know why did I tell this story? Why am I telling you this story? In IIM Bangalore, you are all comfort. I tell them, the day you got your admission letter from IIM Bangalore, you got an admission letter for MBA program. Please understand, God has blessed you to be the top half percentile in the country. You are in the top half income bracket. Not even 1%. You are in the top half percent. I tell them, next 2 years, you count your blessings. You should think like that. Such people will go as far as they can in life. That is the level of leadership that he is talking about. I think I have taken a little more time, but I have to explain this karma yoga leadership only with such examples. You see the next sloka. Utsi deyurime lokaha na kuryam karma chedaham sankarasya chakrakartasyam upahanyami ma prajaha. You know, in Sanskrit, the visarga, the two dots, you know, many a times it becomes lopa. So here it says loka. Actually, when you split it and then recite, you have to say lokaha. That sandhi is in lopa. Sandhi, when you attach, when you combine, the visarga will go. So when you say, you have to say utsi deyu rime lokaha, because you are, it's called avasana, you are creating a break. So that's why some people may wonder why are they reading like that? You know, there is no visarga, he is saying visarga. If you say in one shot, you don't have to say. If you stop there, then the sandhi is broken now. When the sandhi is broken, you have to restore the old form. So this is a technical point I want to just say. Anyway, so he says, Krishna says, you know why I am doing? Otherwise, I'll create a leadership crisis. How will I create a leadership crisis? Utsi deyuhu ibe loka. These people who are looking at me, they are constantly looking at me. I have chosen to be the leader. I am the leader. So all others are constantly looking at me. Na kuryam karma chetaham. If I don't chet, suppose, na kuryat, aham, kim na kuryat, karma na kuryat. If I don't do work, I have valid reason not to do work because I have nothing to achieve. I have no desire. I am desireless. I don't want anything. Therefore, you can say justifiably, I don't have to do work. But who is processing all those details? Leader is not working, let me also not work. So, Yajya Acharya Sreshtaha is still running. You just see what, how much of thinking is going. He says, if I don't do, na kuryam karma chetaham, if I don't do work, whatever be the justifiable reason, they are not going to bother about the reason, they will say, I will also not do. Utsidi yehu ima ime lokaha. That's what he said. They will also abstain from working. They will not see the reason. Why should they see the reason? No, our boss is not doing, I am also not doing. He is not following, I am also not following. My father is not following, I am also not following. This is what is happening in families. This is exactly what is happening. Don't ever try to educate anything to your students. Please live through that principle. Education stops there. Don't open your mouth and tell anything to your youngsters. You live through that, they will be inspired. Krishna is talking about inspirational leadership. You can inspire only by act and deeds, not by talk. Talk is not inspirational, action is inspirational. So this leadership I call it as inspirational leadership. So he says, if they don't do, I will not do. Then this Krishna is so smart. In chapter 1, Arjuna actually mounted heavy arguments. And he said, Varna Sankara Karakaihi. He said, Varna Sankara will happen. He says, no, here only Sankara will happen. For that he gave answer here. Varna Sankara will not happen when you fight. Varna Sankara will happen, all Sankara will happen. Sankara is mixing up, complete messing up. All messing up will happen when leaders stop behaving properly. This is what this country is going through now. This country is going through this tragedy. Leaders have stopped to show by action. They are all good in talking. They have stopped by showing by action. Krishna is saying that is not leadership here. Leadership is action. That is inspirational. Action is inspirational. Talking is not at all inspirational. Action is inspirational. Very, very important. That's why he says, Sankarasya cha karta syam. I may become that person who created this Sankara, not you. In chapter 1, he said, I will by fighting create Varna Sankara. He said, no, I will. Because I keep quiet, everybody keeps quiet, it's complete mess. It's all chaos in the society. So, Sankarasya cha karta syam. Upahanyamima prajaha. So they will all, follow this and then get into that kind of a problem. I will create that kind of a disruption, which is not at all worthwhile. So that is what he says. I will not do it. So the point he is making is, leaders have to behave. Leadership is today understood as one of power, position, endowment of resources, control. Krishna nowhere talks about all that. Nowhere Krishna talks about any of those as leadership. He says these are the leadership traits. Modern leadership theory is completely flawed from the lens of Bhagavad Gita. Modern leadership theory today, 3 hours, because it is a regular MBA class, I first destroyed the modern leadership theory and then talked this in some detail. Three hours I spoke on leadership today between 2 and 5:30. Then I came here actually. So modern leadership theory is all about power, position, entitlement, endowment of resources, control. I can, sanction, leave to you or not leave to you. This is the lens of leadership we have. I can, decide how much sanction I will do, financial resources, human resources, whatever you need, I will now sanction. That is what I am a leader. It is all circulating in that level. Krishna is nowhere bringing any of those. He is saying, can you make it inspirational? That's what he is saying. Sakta karmanya vidvamsaha yata kurvanti bharata kuryat vidvamstata saktaha chikirshur loka sangraham. There are a lot of sandhis here. That's why you saw some Veda when I... So let me explain that. Saktaha karmani avidvamsaha. See, there is another visarga sandhi. The visarga, the two dot, will become u, and then it will become a guna also. It will become o. That's why you get a o there. That vidvamso is in a sandhi. If you have to break it and read, vidvamsaha, you have to say. Vidvamsaha, you have to say, sorry. Vidvamsaha, you have to say. That in Sandhi will become Vidvamso. Okay? Similarly, in the next, Kuryat. If you have to do a Patacheda there, Kuryat. Okay? Vidvamsaha. Tata Saktaha. Chikirshuhu. Lokasangraham. All these are all, sometimes the two dots will become ir, repa. Sometimes it becomes is. These are all the complications. The two dots that you call visarga, when you combine it, it can disappear. I already showed one example. Loka, it was there, I said Loka. Or it become O. It has become O here. Or it will become is, Sakara will come, or it will become Ir. Here, you know, you will see a Kuryat Vidvam Stata Vidvam. Stata Saktaha. There is a Sakara Saktaha, then Cha. The Sa becomes Sha. So Chikish, Chikish, like that it is there. So these are all the complications, but don't worry about it. Little bit I want to educate you also Sanskrit, because it will go a long way in understanding a lot of shlokas also when you see. It's just pattern. Sanskrit is a very structured, scientific language. If you know a little pattern, you can bulldoze language Sanskrit in no time. Anyway, so Saktaha. Saktaha means attached people. Attached to what? Attached to Pala. What is in it for me? There are people, actually these people who want to attach results work like mad. So Krishna says, if they don't get results, they may get destroyed. That's a different issue. But I think they really work like anything to somehow turn everything to get what they want. It's a very common trend which we see. Let's say use of the word saktaha. Huh? And the saktaha are who? They are avidvamsaha. See, the karmani plus a becomes karmanya. E will become e. Yakara will come. It's called yansandhi. So plus a becomes ya. So there is a akara there. It is avidvamsaha. They are not vidvamsa. They are avidvamsa. They are ignorant people. Because they are ignorant people, they are after pala. After so much of karma yoga, you should have the audacity to say, call them as avidvamsa only. So, avidvamsaha saktaha karmani yatha kurvanti. These people who are all in what is in it for me, they really put their best foot forward. They put their best foot forward, do hook by hook or crook. They may indulge in all adharmic. But the fact remains, they really put their effort, get they what they want. So Krishna is not talking about the adharmic part, he is talking about the energy that is going in, not the method by which. He is talking about there is so much energy going in. That is all he is bringing here. So he says, this avidvamsaha saktaha karmani yatha kurvanti, the way they engage in work, by turn everything, bend every rule, hook or crook, they achieve what they want to achieve, spend a lot of energy and get what they want. Yata evam kurvanti, he Bharata, O son of the Bharata Vamsa, who is Arjuna, that is an adjective for Arjuna, he says, tata, tata is somewhere in between. See, in Sanskrit there are nice yata tata, yada tada, yatra tatra, so there are nice structures. Yata, there will be a tata. Just like that, in the same way. So tata means in the same way. Yata, yata raja, tata praja. That's an example of yata tata. Yata raja, tata praja. Yadya jatari jrishraha, tadya deva itare janaha. Same thing. Ha. Tata, in the same way. Vidvamsaha, here it's not avidvamsaha. In the second line, it is vidvamsaha. Kuryat. An enlightened person also will bring that much energy. The commonality is only the energy part. Please understand. The commonality is only the energy part. So the avidvamsa and saktaha, they are brought into the example just to tell they turn the world and then get what they want. So they spend that much energy. In the same way also only vidvamsa will also do. Chikirshuhu. The word chikirshuhu is a very nice word in Sanskrit. See, in Sanskrit, it's a very, very compact language. Chikirshuhu means one who wants to do work. Kartum ichyati is called chikirshuhu. See, thirsty is called pipasa. Because there is a desire to drink. It's called desiderative form in English. Desire to drink. Bubuksha means desire to eat. Means I am hungry. So chikirsha or chikirshuhu. Chikirshuhu, a person who is desirous of working. He wants to work. Who? Vidvamsa. Yata, tata, like that fellow, which means he will also bring a lot of energy, but his focus is Lokasangraha. Chikirshuhu, Lokasangraham, their desire to bring enormous energy, Subhashini Mistri brought that energy. She brought energy. You can imagine, a domestic helper can build a hospital, I should, you know, hang my head in shame. What am I doing here? That is energy. Same energy she brought, but the focus of energy is not sakta. They are asaktas. They have no desire for themselves. Lokasangraham. Chenakadeha lokasangraham evartam samparshan kartumargasi. 20th shloka. That is what it is. Lokasangraham. Their energy is directed for lokasangraha. That is what they want to spend their energy on. So the commonality between vidvamsa and avidvamsa is the amount of energy. The difference is their focus is what is in for me. And the focus of these karma yogis are lokasangraham. The charm of lokasangraham cannot be paralleled. Cannot be paralleled. We need to experience it in whatever little way we can. We must all do our own lokasangraham. There is a lot of fulfillment of the heart. That is the goal of life. That is what this chapter is all about. That's why I love this chapter. This is all about world of Vyavahara. Only when you ripen in the world of Vyavahara, you are ready for jnana. That's why when Arjuna asked, he drove him away. He said, no. You are not still ripe enough. You are asking questions which are immature questions. Do lokasangraha. That is the idea. Then he ends this stream of thoughts with a shloka. Na buddhi bedam janayet ajnanam karma sanginam joshayet sarva karmani vidvan yukta samacharan. Finally, Krishna leaves a note of warning. After having said so much about work and all that, he leaves a note of warning. He says, Na buddhi bedam janayet. Don't confuse people who are yet to get evolved. Na buddhi bedam janayet. Don't confuse their understanding of life. People, please understand, people are in the continuum. Some are little evolved, some are little more evolved, some are little more evolved, some are even more evolved. The charm of this society is 1,000 flowers will blossom. 1,000 flowers has to blossom. Each one is of a different color and smell and odor and whatever it is. So all people are not the same. Prakriti visesha. So some people are more evolved, some people are less evolved. So therefore he says that those ajnanam karma sanginam, these people who are all these ajnanis, who are all so much pala and karma, let them do it. Don't disturb them too much. Slowly you ramp them up. Don't go and tell them, you know, all that what you are doing are all nonsense. Krishna has said them, no, I think everything has to happen gradually. So don't disturb, because they may need more capacity to take it. They may need more time. That's why he said, the 65 of us will not come by accident. We have actually been ramped into the slope so much. Because otherwise you cannot listen even for a minute. Nobody can listen it even for a minute if you are not evolved. We are all blessed. We are all blessed. God's grace is already with us. That's why we are sitting here for this fifth day. We are sitting. We are going to spend 10 and a half hours here. Beyond 5 minutes you cannot sit if you are not ready. Because this is not, pacifying your indriya sukha. Nothing of this kind. It's not drama going on here. Seriously, we are talking. That's what Krishna is saying. Don't, go and then make jittery of people. In your anxiety that is the vidya is so good. So let's pull everybody and say, come here. No, it will not work. It's a very realistic idea. He says, Na buddhi bedam janayet ajnanam karma sanginam. Don't do that. Because if you do it, they will get confused. Joshayet sarva karmani. Neither here nor there. Lots of people are that variety. Neither here nor there. Because, there is one thing which sort of bothers me a little bit. Today a lot of people are saying, see, the problem is, first of all, we haven't read ancient Indian wisdom very well. Honestly, because, we have been in a Machiavellian kind of a educational system, we have come. So honestly, we have not read enough. But I keep saying this again and again. I keep giving this example. If you ask me about anesthesia, I will not tell you anything, because I don't know. I have not read. If you ask me about polymer chemistry, I will not say anything because I don't know. I am not a polymer chemist. If you ask me about management, I will tell a little bit because 30 years I have hit my wall against management. Something I know, so I will blabber something. That much I will do. But if you ask me about ancient Indian wisdom, I will go to the rooftop and say all these are nonsense. This is the preoccupation of average Indian today. Ancient Indian wisdom is the only piece of knowledge we have free license to comment about that without knowing anything. This is a problem I am seeing. Because all these conversation going on, whether Bhagavad Gita is good or bad, I will ask all of them to come and say, wow. I will ask them, what have you learnt here? Have you ever learnt? Have you ever tried? Have you ever experienced anything? This we ask, if you want me to take a job for accounting, you ask me, do you have a degree? Do you know accounting? If you ask me, if you want me to give a job in pharma industry, you ask me how much of pharmacy you have read. If you ask me about electrical engineering, you ask me, do you know some electrical engineering? He knows, I don't know much. He knows a lot of electrical engineering, right? But the ancient Indian wisdom, we don't ask that question. We usurp a position without knowing what it is and tell, no, no, don't do any karma, all that matter. I mean, this is a fancy thing I have heard any number of times. No, you don't have to do anything. You have to be very clean in your heart. You have to be very pure in your heart. Your purity in your heart will not come by thinking, by doing a manana 1,000 times. You have to be clean in your heart. Through work only you can become clean. I tell you, every one of us, I very much differ with a lot of people. Every one of us must have religion, spirituality and secularism or materialism in equal measure. Achara vichara is very important. It will clean you up. It will really bring you discipline. See, if somebody wants to win an Olympic gold, you have to see his regimen. He can't eat this, he can't do that, 7 hours he has run, morning 9, 7 to 5 to 7 he has to do something, 7 to 8, you can't say I will not do all that. If you have to win an Olympic, for an Olympic gold, if you have so much regimen, if you want to escape this samsara chakra, this chakra of birth and death, if you want to escape, the regimen has to be very tight. Don't think that you can give up all. See, for modern society they say no achara, nothing. Clean mind is enough. You will be proven wrong. It can be, of course, the religion should not be used for all kinds of nonsense which is going on. I tell you, my personal life is, I am a very religious person. People ask me, who are, can you describe you? I am an modern orthodox person. I use a very oxymoron kind of a word because I have a lot of achara vichara, but there is no way I can see anybody differently. I have as much respect to my servant mind to as much to my director. You can come, you know, that's how we practice our life. You have to, don't have to mix one with the other. Religion is for personal achara. Don't bring it out and create complications. Without personal achara, you will never progress. Achara vichara is very important. That gives you the muscle for a greater regimen of upasana. Karma, achara vichara, that will take you to upasana. Upasana will take you to jnana. I don't believe in this leapfrogging business and all that. I mean, if you try, I wish you, chitta shuddhi will not happen. So that is what he is saying. He is saying buddhi bedam na janaye joshe sarva karmani. Don't confuse people. Help them. Help them slowly, slowly let them pick up, because the turning will happen slowly, and allow that, facilitate that process. A karma yogi should do that. Should not usurp again this arrogance that I have a superior knowledge which you don't have, and then look down upon people. All those Krishna's, that's the last warning he gives after so much of discussion he has done about karma yoga. That's the last warning he gives. So let me sort of summarize these leadership things that we have actually gone through. Krishna is saying leadership is far more challenging. Why? It is to develop a capability to give up everything, even when all resources are at one's own disposal. That's not easy. You should be able to know how to take your hands off and say, I will have such a aparigraha. It's called aparigraha. Gandhiji practiced it so well. He says in 1903, when there was a plague, If you read his book, my experience is good. It's all fantastic. He says in Johannesburg, south of Johannesburg, there was a plague. Big plague in some 1907 or 1908 or something. He says, There are two bachelors, four, five bachelors. He is a married man. After a few days, he told the bachelors, go away. There is a risk of you contracting disease. He has a family. He has a few children. He says, no, I will handle. I will handle. The South African government was stunned. One single individual single-handedly quarantined a set of people. Against all odds, they quarantined the plague and then completely eliminated it. He describes that. Then one judge, one South African judge, so moved by what he saw. So at that time, his salary was some £300, 1905. Big money apparently. So apparently this judge said, I will give you £270. I don't want £30 is called aparigraha. This is the minimum I want. £270, you do a cast, I want to give it to you. All these he writes in his book, My Experiments in Truth. So, ability to give up everything, even when all resources are at one's own disposal, to me that is empowerment. Empowerment is not holding on to everything. You are truly empowered when you say, I can take my hands off with nothing. That is true empowerment. That is what a leader will have to practice if you read the slokas. Engaging in action, even when there is no fruit or there is no need for fruits of action. There may be no fruits of action. Think of Subhashini Mistry's humanitarian hospital. There is no need for fruit of action. There is no fruits of action. That is not going to benefit her at all by any stretch of imagination. It is benefiting a large community of people. And she sees the joy of that. That's the true leader, inspirational leader. Walking the talk, which is a very serious issue today for practice. Krishna talks about it. It's a lofty management principles also. Not only Vedanta. Vedanta and management go together. That is why I am surviving in IIM Bangalore. Loka Sangraham is the overarching objective. For a true leader, Loka Sangraham is the overarching objective for a true leader. Couple of slokas we will take. We have 10 minutes, so we can take a couple of slokas. Then he changes the course of conversation a little bit with a pair of slokas and moves into something. Look at this shloka. Prakrute kriyamanani gunai karmani sarvashah ahankara vimudhatma kartahamiti manyate. So he defines who is a jnani and who is a ajnani. In this shloka he defines an ajnani, how will an ajnani approach work. In the next shloka he defines how will a jnani approach his work. How do you recognize a jnani and an ajnani? So he uses this particular So prakritehe kriyamanani gunaihi karmani sarvashah. All work that every one of us do, Krishna says, is done because when you are born, you are born with guna and karma. Guna, karma, vibhagashah, chaturvarnyam, all those are there. Each one of us is nothing but a bundle of guna, RGB, I told. It's a color palette in which I picked my RGB and came with the color. Sattva, Rajas, Tamas. That is RGB, color palette. So each one of us came with a certain combination of S, R and T. Sattva guna, Rajo guna and Tamo guna. That will actually determine the response to a situation. Krishna is going very deep into how action happened. We think we are... So he says, Ahankara vimudhatma. This mudhatma. See, mudha itself is... He has put a upasarga V. V missing means visesha. So he is extraordinarily a mudha. The mudha itself is an idiot. He has put a upasarga V, vimudha. V means vaisishtam, visesham. So this fellow is an extraordinarily an idiot. So that is the word he uses. Vimudhatma, that person who is such an ignorant and an idiotic fellow, he says, I am doing. Ahankara vimudatma, his vimuda, his foolishness comes out of ahankar. So karta aham, aham karta iti manyate. He says I am doing. So that's why I told that Stafford Beer, that article which he wrote, in which he said, every day I pass through my neighbor's house, this dog will ferociously bark at me, and it has so much of ahankar to think I have done the job. He says, the dog has not done the job. It is wired with a certain property, it will keep shouting. That's why sometimes when you go fast, the dog will chase you fast. It's so ignorant, it thinks its job is done. It is its prakriti. Its prakriti is making it to do. It is not thinking and then deciding, this fellow we have to go at 10 kilometers per hour, this fellow we have to go 20 kilometers per hour, at him we have to bark ferociously, at him we have to bark, nothing. There is a prakriti which it is reacting. He says, we are also like that. Krishna says, the deepest psychology is, the work we do is a function of who you are. Or the response you do to a situation is a function of what you are. And how are you made of? He says, gunaihi. Prakritehe kriyamanani gunai. Gunai, this guna came from where? Guna came from prakriti. This world of nature is called prakriti. This creation process has prakriti and purusha with which it creates a livable entity. The prakriti is the jada. Purusha is the sentient part, the live part. You put both of them, life comes. The child is born. The purusha enters into the prakriti. Prakriti is jada. That's why when the purusha goes, it becomes jada, na? You can't do anything with that hand or leg or something. If you keep it for too long, it will start smelling. You have to dispose it off very fast. This prakriti is jada. But that is a raw material. Into it, this paramatma becomes a jivatma and comes inside like a purusha and wires the whole thing and enlivens it. So he says, your ahankara, a person, this is a very deep spiritual idea also. See, how are we made of? Sankhya system says we are made of 24 elements. Sankhya system says we are made of 24 elements. What are the 24 elements? Pancha tanmatras, pancha bhutas, pancha karmendriyas, pancha jnanendriyas, 4 into 5, 20. Pancha tanmatras. Tanmatra means it's not enough you have eye. You need a property of seeing. There is a tanmatra called seeing. It's not enough you have a ear which looks like a ear. A deaf also has a ear which looks like this. You need a tanmatra of hearing. It's a property. So pancha tanmatras, pancha bhutas, pancha karmendriyas, pancha jnanendriyas, 4 into 5, 20. Manas, buddhi, chitta, ahankara. Plus 4, 24. Sankhya says, these are all called prakriti. Then there is, these are all jada. Then something called purusha. So purusha, mahat, they use the word. Purusha and prakriti make a living being. So what is Krishna saying here? The ahankara is a lower eye. It is not the bigger eye. There is a difference between ahankara and the jivatma. We are not, who am I? You cannot take my passport and say he is Mahadevan. Well, the Mahadevan one day will go. The soul will not go. The Mahadevan, the passport, the professor are all lower eye, not a bigger eye. Each one of us, when we relate to the body, when we relate to the 24 elements, buddhi, chitta, ahankara, we are talking of lower eye. The lower eye cannot do anything, it is jada. It is a higher eye which can do. And, when you are in waking state, the sthula sharira is active. When you are in sopna, sthula sharira is gone. But your sukshma sharira is fully active. With your mind you can go to catch a flight, go to New York, talk to somebody and then come back and then have a cup of coffee in the coffee day and then go somewhere. All that can happen. Which means your sukshma sharira is working. The indriyas are all working in a soft copy, not in a hard copy. When you get into deep sleep, Sushupti, a beggar and a king of the Rahul Gandhi and the beggar can comfortably sleep side by side because they have shed everything. Stula sarira is gone, sukshma sarira is gone, buddhi is gone, chitta is gone, ahankara is gone. When somebody is in deep sleep, you can put a cobra on top of him, nothing will happen. Because his body is jada, no? His chitta is not working, ahankara is not working, buddhi is not working. That is why it is. Once he wakes up, he will start running. So, trying to relate trying to attach myself to the lower I is an ajnani. A jnani will not do it. Jnani will do it slightly differently. He will not do it like this. So let us see how jnani will do. So Krishna's teaching says, so the ajnani have to keep on doing work also. Why? Because he should get chitta shuddhi. He has to get chitta shuddhi. That is why he will do work. So jnani also will do work. Ajnani also will do work. Ajnani will do work to ramp up in this plane through chitta shuddhi and find the loka sangraha. Whereas jnani will do work. Why? He says how he will do. He says, tatva vittu mahabaho gunakarma vibhagayoho guna guneshu vartante iti matvana sajjate. The vartante in sandhi will become vartanta. Ekara will go. That is the first thing you found. Vartante will become vartanta in sandhi. When you split it, it will become vartante. The mahabaho is mahabaho. It is actually vocatory. It's called sambodhana pradama. So it is not the other O. Anyway. So he says, tatva vitta. Person who has understood tat. That. The intrinsic property of existence is tat. Om tat sat, we say, no? That tat. Tat tvamasi, shvetaketu, in Chandogya Upanishad. Tat is that essence of existence. So, tatva vit, the person who has understood that substratum of everything, tu indeed, he mahabaho, this is the adjective for Arjuna. This person with a grand shoulder and all that, I mean, a very mighty soldier, Mahabaho. And what tattva he understood? Guna karma vibhagayoho. How is guna and karma related? The guna is driving the karma. Ahankara vimudatmana. This tattva with knows, guna karma separation he knows. The guna is prakriti, that is driving the karma. I should step off from all this. I should not unnecessarily get engaged into it. I should not make myself party to it. He has that level of thinking. Because he has that level of thinking, what is he doing? Guna guneshu vartante. All that is happening because of guna. I am not the guna. It's all happening because of guna. I am not involved. The bigger I is, you are distancing yourself. You are the real big I, not the small I. In the earlier case, the small I is understood to be big I and say, because of ahankara, I did, and then you carry all the problems on your head and then get into trouble, get into, you know, sukha, dukkha and so on. Here, this fellow understood guna and karma have an intricate relationship. I have temporarily leased this body. All these jada padarthas, they are not chit, they are jada padarthas. I have temporarily leased them. I am much bigger than all these, so let me keep off. That kind of a thinking will go in him. Guna guneshu vartante iti matva na sajjate. He doesn't get involved in the process at all. In fact, on seeing somebody, you can never find out whether he is a jnani or not a jnani. So one of the, you know, Swami Prabhananda Bharati, I had a wonderful 40 hours with him. 2 months I went for a class. He used to give wonderful examples. He says, a great cook, a wonderful cook, does not have to carry the shout all the time with him to say, I am the cook. That's the example he gives. He doesn't have to say, I am a great cook, and in order to say that, carry the shout, one of those, this thing, vessel. He says, no, not required. By his action, you will find. Similarly, a jnani shows by what he does, not by what he shows or what he appears to be. So this is how a jnani will look like. Krishna says, this is how a jnani will look like. So we'll stop here. Only thing I am saying is Krishna's teaching of karma yoga. So jnani also will do karma yoga now. Jnani is brought into the fold of karma yoga. Only thing he said is, jnani's reason why he does karma yoga is chitta, you know, is loka sangraha. This is what Krishna said. Mama atman vartante manushya partha saraso. I will keep on doing. But know what is in it for me. Loka sangraham. So who is a jnani? I think on that note we will stop here and then we will continue tomorrow. Om Sahana Bhavatu Sahanau Bhunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tej तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः श्रीकृष्णार्पणमस्तु श्रीगुरुचरणारविन्दार्पणमस्तु श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ